Okay. Good afternoon. I am Ana Dieguez. I am a PhD student, and I am going to talk about precision beekeeping and how this tool could help us and the beekeeper for fighting against Vespa velutina in our region, that is Galicia. So first, a short introduction about precision beekeeping. It can be considered a branch of precision agriculture. Our objective is to anticipate and predict events that may cause colonies' disappearance or death, like in our case of Vespa velutina, but also with the problem with Varroa in our region. Okay, precision beekeeping is an apiary management strategy based on the monitoring of individual bee colonies to minimize resources consumption and maximize the productivity of the honeybees. Precision beekeeping is split in three phases. The first one is the data collection, that is throughout the sensors. As you can see here in the picture, this is an internal sensor of humidity, temperature, and sound, and also external sensors, as you can see here, the two scales, and also they have sensors of external temperature and humidity. Then the second phase, that is the data analysis, and the third one, that is the application. So I'm going to start with the first one. Okay. You can measure in the apiaries a lot of things, and also in the honeybee colonies. The first one that you can measure is the temperature, also external and internal. And in this case, I'm going to talk about the internal temperature. And this measure what can give to you. In the literature, it says that you can define the pre-swarming with temperatures between 34 and 38 degrees inside of the colony. The problem with this is that it depends on the sensor position. In our case, our sensor is between the brood chamber and the cover, but also you can put the sensor in the brood. You can put the sensor in one side or in another, so it depends of the sensor position. It's because of that there is not warning to set to us that the swarm is going to occur. Also, the temperature can give us information about the brood status. Also, the literature said that to have a brood in the hive, in the colony, you have to be measures between 32 and 36 degrees inside of the hive. But the thing is, the internal temperature is related with external temperatures, and it is difficult because of the position of the sensor to have these values between 32 and 33 and 33. And also, as I said before, the sensor is not in the brood. Also, the temperature can give us information about the healthy status of the colony. Unusual temperature variation can gives us can predict that maybe it's time to go to the apiary and visit the colony. And about the death, when the internal temperature arrived to the external temperature, it could be also time to it is time to go to the apiary and visit it. But again, because of the sensor position, and in winter time, that is the time when you cannot open the colonies, and it's important to know what is happening inside without opening it. The winter wall occurs and because of the sensor could be in another, in the other frame or in another position, and also because of this is this sensors are kind of are disturbing the honeybees, so they are gonna evit that place to place next to the sensor, and the winter wall will be in another frame, not in the sensor position. So also we can measure humidity. Again, for to have a good healthy status in our colony, we have to have values between 53 and 61% of relative humidity inside of the hive. The humidity should be less than 90% in our colony, but it will depend on the external humidity. As you know, and if you don't know, I will tell you. In Galicia, we have a really high values of humidity, external humidity. So sometimes in our beehives, we will have values more than 90%. And also, but it could give us information about fungi disease. So it's a good tool. Also about the death, it happens the same with the temperature. And with the brood, it is said that with values less than 50% of humidity, there will be less brood in the colony. But this sensor is really distorted by propolis and wax, so it is really sensitive, this one, and we have to be careful about this. Also, we can measure the weight. The scales will be under the beehive. We can know what is happening with the nectar flow, also the productivity and the colony growth. It could help the beekeepers to select monofloral honeys if they want harvest them. Also, the scale will help to detect the swarming, but we cannot predict it, so it will be we will know it. That's the only. Also, the death of the colony, and estimate the number of honeybees that enter and leave per day. But we have to be careful because also with the rain that distort the values. And also with the stones, that is kind of a joke, but beekeepers put the stones up the beehive, and also they take it off. So we should know what is happening with the management of the beekeeper. And about the sound, the literature said again that you can know the presence of or absence of the queen, that if there is a mate queen inside of the colony, we are gonna have frequencies between 350 and 500. And if you don't have a mate queen in your colony, you will have a frequency between 300 and 1500. Also, it will help us to identify different Apis mellifera species. Also, about the health status of the colony during the winter. And also, I saw in a paper that talk about the workers under stress that are gonna have 300, that are gonna have frequencies between 300 and 350. But as you can see here, this is the same frequency with an old mate queen, so we are gonna have sounds overlapping all the time, and it's really difficult to identify some stressor or some moment, determined moment. Also, it could give us information about the pre-swarming and about the death. But here, with the sounds, we have to ha take into account the environmental sounds, the sounds that are overlapping, and there is no single sounds inside of the colony. So, also the second phase of the precision beekeeping is the phase draws conclusions that regarding bee colony behavior and activity and trend based on measurement data, predefined models and expert knowledge. So that's the problem with the monitoring system that are for Shell, that because there are a lot and each one is totally different, we have to learn about each one. So what we do in our study, okay, first, Vespa velutina, why it's gonna be a tool for us to fight again Vespa velutina. Vespa velutina provoke in our apiaries confinement periods. In our region, it starts in mid-June until 25 of December or until winter. So this provoked that the honeybees cannot forage, and this provoked that the honeybees are gonna start consume their stocks, their food stocks. So the decrease of the food stocks start, and also when it arrives to our region, beekeepers should go to the apiaries frequently to know what is happening with the honeybees and the pressure in the apiaries. So now, what we use in our study, here, as you can see, we select an apiary and we select two colonies. We put the scales under the colonies. These scales will give us information measures each 10 minutes. Also, we will have an internal sensor that of humidity and temperature that give us also data each 10 minutes. And also the external humidity and the temperature sensors that will be in the scales that also will give us measures each 10 minutes. Also, the sound was measured, but because of the overlapping of the sounds of the environmental sounds, we cannot have any conclusion to set. So, and this with this also we put a camera in front of the two beehives to that took pictures each hour and give us information about the activity of the colony, if the honeybees were outside or there was activity, or how many hornets were in front of the apiary. So the next one, we analyzed two things: the Vespa velutina behavior in between mid-June and December in front of the hives. And we also study the difference between the two colonies with the internal sensors and the scale. So we saw about the Vespa velutina behavior, we saw that the external parameters, how it affect hornets, we saw that with precipitation less than 20 liters meter quadra meter, Vespa velutina start appearing in the apiaries, that the higher number of hornets will be with the low precipitation. Also about the humidity, we saw that they prefer relative humidity higher than 40% to start appearing in the apiaries, that they don't mind to have 100% of humidity to be in the apiary, And also that the highest number of hornets will be at more or less 80% of external humidity. And about the temperature, as you can see here, they started appearing with temperatures between 7 and 32 degrees, and they prefer the 20 degrees to be in the apiary. This is about the behavior. And also, we saw that in around that year, in that place, in summer months when the temperature is higher than 32 in the midday, they prefer to hunt or to visit the colonies in the morning or in the evening. So in summer months, it's difficult to see hornets in the midday between 2 and 4 in the afternoon. But what happened in September, the month with the highest number of hornets in the apiary, and that is September, but also it is influenced by its life cycle, because it's the moment where the major number of hornets is in the nest. So in September, it was the month with the highest pressure because of its life cycle, but also because the mild weather conditions. And about the autumn months, totally different to the summer months, we saw that when temperature is around 20, the hornets follow the same pattern as the temperature, and the higher number of hornets in front of the beehives were found in the midday between 2 and 4. And about what happened now with the colonies, we saw here, you can see the first one. These two graphs are for the colony one, and these two graphs for the colony two. Here, the first one is the temperature, and the second one is the humidity. The first one is the orange lines are for the internal conditions, and the blue one for the external. And here is the same, okay? Temperature, humidity, temperature, humidity. And we put it the sensors the 7th of February, okay? That is here. So we saw in the first one and in the second about the humidity that the humidity were between with values between 50 and 90. I think that you cannot say so, but here is 15 and 90, and here is the same, 50 and 90. So yes. But yeah, about the temperature, we saw that the first one, the colony one, has values between 20 and 40, and the colony two between 20 and 30. So we thought, because we visit the apiary and we measure the strength and the healthy status of the colony, we know that the colony two has more thermoregulation than colony one. Also, colony two has a better health status and strength, and also has the higher population inside of the colony. So you see the difference more or less here. And about the weight, we could measure and also for the beekeeper is what it helps to measure the nectar flow, as you can see here and here. But here, as you see, the colony two, you can see better the nectar flow and the colony evolution. You can see also values that vary because of the harvest, the treatment, the management practice, and everything. And also we saw here and here that this in not with the pressure of Vespa velutina, but here yes, we could see here that in the last one that the food, the decrease the food stocks, but also we saw here the confinement period that Vespa velutina produced in the two colonies. Also, we saw that not in this picture, but in other years, we saw more Vespa velutinas in the weekend colony than in the in front of the weekend colony than in the strong one. And to conclude, when we saw that data, we talked to the beekeeper and the food was provided to the colonies. And also, when we start to show the Vespa velutina in the apiaries, we talk to him to start with the control methods. And some conclusions of the study. First, that it's true that minimize the management, that the beekeeper can synchronize its management with the colony activity. That it helps not to disturb the colonies as now, that we have real-time measurement of parameters, that monitor nectar sources in places where there are no hives yet. Also for us, a lot of all the apiaries are in rural areas, and it is really complicated to arrive the that places. So it's a good thing to monitor that apiaries and not have to go all the time. It give us also winter information, but it's difficult to interpret the data. Also because the sensors and the monitoring system are still starting, we have some problems. You saw in the graphics that sometimes work and sometimes not. So, but it's a good starting, and I think this year we will implement this system in another apiaries, and we will see what is happening. And thank you. And that's it.